Up next on Honda Racing at Speed, Honda brings a superstar to the 101st Indy 500 and drives away with the most surprising and historic victory. The Acura NSX GT3 race car continues its growth in IMSA and Pirelli World Challenge. Meantime, Michael Shank Racing undertakes a motorsports sojourn for the ages. All that and more next on this edition of Honda Racing at Speed.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Honda Racing at Speed. I'm Rick Benjamin. We're at Indy, Indianapolis Motor Speedway, as you can probably tell, where the 101st running of the Indianapolis 500 is now in the books. Honda's IndyCar stars were aces on this race day. For the third time in 4 years, Honda makes its way to victory lane.
It was a wild day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Hondas had the upper hand almost from the start. Six Hondas starting in the first three rows, 14 of the fastest 17 starters with Honda power. 2008 500 winner Scott Dixon led from the pole and dominated the early stages before being taken out by a violent wreck with fellow Honda driver Jay Howard.
Just before that, you're trying to, you know, slow the car down as much as possible and get it out of harm's way. But in that incident, it was just wasn't to be.
Once Dixon was done, the first half of this year's 500 saw several Honda aces run strong and lead laps. Ryan Hunter-Reay, defending champion Alexander Rossi, and two-time world champion Fernando Alonso, who electrified fans all month long. Hunter-Reay's chances ended with a mechanical failure, as did Alonso's, both late in the going. But Alonso earned everyone's respect and surely thinks he has unfinished business at the Speedway.
I was passing and watching the tower. I saw the 29 on top of it, and I was thinking at that moment if Zach or someone from the team was taking a picture of that tower, because I want that picture at home.
It was a caution-filled day, a variety of incidents taking out many contenders, but it was also a day for some of the sport's less familiar faces to flex their muscles and take a shot at racing immortality. As the final stages of this year's 500 approached, Honda's contenders included strong rookie Ed Jones and Dale Coyne's 19, Max Chilton carrying Chip Ganassi Racing's hopes on his 8 car, and Takuma Sato, he along with Marco Andretti, the last men standing for Andretti Autosport. One final caution set up one last restart in this year's 500, and over the final 15 laps, an epic battle between Sato, Jones, and a certain three-time Indy 500 winner. Sato, who came so close to winning here 5 years earlier, had learned his lessons well from that close call. Sato powering to the lead and holding all at bay to score the upset victory.
Today is just beyond anything. It's just a superb feeling of that. It's just, I cannot thank anyone else.
The first-year standout Jones, all the way from Dubai, was impressive all afternoon, grabbing third for the Coyne team's best-ever finish at Indy.
Seemed like we always kept coming back, and with the strategy, we were lucky with that last yellow. But we were always there, and we had the pace to do it.
For team principal Coyne, a dream day, capping off a tough month.
A great group of guys together. I mean, we're still lean and mean, but it's a really good group.
Sato delivered Honda's and Andretti's third 500 win in 4 years, and Honda's 12th overall.
And I'm joined by 2017 Indy 500 winner, Takuma Sato. Takuma, congratulations. What a stellar drive today.
Thank you very much.
It was a tough fight at the end with the Ilio, certainly. You came close here 5 years ago. Did you learn anything from that experience that helped you today?
Absolutely. Every single moment is helping. Dario's battle back in 2012, it was a big lesson. I know it was respect the things, not to hit the guy. But then I sort of like I was on the white line because of that. So today I just make sure my line myself, and obviously Helio, this is a guy so hungry to win, because he's a champion, a three-time winning here. How to win? He knows how to win it. But it was a great battle, Andretti Autosport, my number 26, fantastic job. Honda gave me a great package, and we had a tool to fight with them.
It is almost as big as a race win, taking the pole for the Indy 500. The battle for pole honors this year was breathtaking. After 2 days of drama and lightning fast speeds, the winner of the pole for the 500 was Honda's most accomplished IndyCar pilot.
After 2 days and two rounds of chasing speed, four-time IndyCar champion Scott Dixon earned his third 500 pole.
For Dixon, who won the pole in the race back in 2008, his speed of more than 232 miles an hour was the fastest qualifying effort since Ari Lyndike nearly hit 237 21 seasons ago.
Huge thank you to Honda. They've shown some dominance, I think, in the speed that they've had this weekend. Now it's focused on race day.
Hondas were stout all weekend, six in the fast nine. The most closely watched, though, was two-time world champion Fernando Alonso, in command all the way, earning a row two starting spot in the 500 at more than 231 miles an hour.
I was definitely very happy with the car. Now it's time to race in traffic, in all these things. So it will be interesting to go through this week and keep learning.
Outside the fast nine, Honda was even more dominant. Ryan Hunter-Reay laid down the fourth fastest speed of the weekend in second round qualifying, good for 10th starting spot.
It's unfortunate because we didn't really have the opportunity to go for pole, but you know, that's the way it goes. It's just our luck this weekend, and we put up a great time to finish off the weekend.
In all, 14 of the first 17 starters were Honda-powered, 15 of the top 20.
But the month of May ends on a sad note. One of Honda's most accomplished racing stars, former MotoGP world champion Nicky Hayden, has passed away from injuries he suffered in a bicycle accident several days ago. Nicky Hayden was the 2006 MotoGP world champion. He was riding his bike near Rimini in Italy in a training ride. He collided with a car, suffering multiple serious injuries. Hayden was from Owensboro, Kentucky. He was widely loved and respected throughout motorsport and worldwide, not just for his speed on two wheels, but for his character and personal qualities. Nicky Hayden was 35. We'll be right back.
Honda Racing at Speed is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams, Honda Racing, and Honda Performance Development. Find out more at hpd.honda.com.
Welcome back to Honda Racing at Speed. It's certainly been one of the most exciting elements of this year's month of May, the arrival of two-time world champion Fernando Alonso, passing on the Monaco Grand Prix to come and run the 101st Indy 500. Alonso driving a McLaren Honda Andretti machine, orange in livery as usual, carrying the number 29. Alonso has attracted a huge fan following right from the start, and his effort here has been nothing short of amazing.
I will learn, starting from zero as a rookie or even less than a rookie, but I'm confident that we will be ready. Or I'm with the best team possible. I'm also with the coach, Gilles de Ferran, which I'm sure will be very, very useful for all these new things that I need to learn.
You certainly realize very quickly you're dealing with a novice or a newcomer in by any stretch of the imagination. You know, you're dealing with someone that has a special gift and a seasoned professional with all the good things that come with that. So it's more about bringing to his awareness new challenges and new situations that he may encounter in this type of racing, you know, and then being there as a soundboard. We can review as many situations in the past as you like, but there's nothing like experiencing everything yourself.
This race is so unique and so big, you know, that to experience those emotions and to drive in that place that day is something that everyone is telling me to enjoy.
Well, before the drink of milk, back home again in Indiana, the BorgWarner Trophy, and all the other things that make up the Indy 500, Honda's IndyCar stars kicked off the month of May going backwards and through the infield here. Kyle Benjamin tells us Honda's aces were hoping to kick things off with a great day at the IndyCar Grand Prix.
Four-time IndyCar champion and 2008 Indy 500 winner Scott Dixon rattled off a top-five finish in each of the first five IndyCar races in 2017.
Hopefully we can peak at the right time and start picking a few off here.
Prophetic words, he did go out and grab the pole for the 101st Indy 500 after all. Dixie would carry the water for Honda during the Indy GP. He started fourth behind a couple of those other silver cars and jumped to third by turn two. He stayed anchored there for most of the race, smooth and steady for 85 laps, finally moving into the runner-up spot in the race's waning moments.
It was definitely a tough day. You know, I think the biggest problem for us was just trying to hold on to the rear tires. I think the Honda engine just had too much power, man. We were peeling them off. So it was nice at the end there to run on new reds, and we closed that gap. But just, you know, I think later in the run, we just couldn't hold on to the rear of the car.
St. Pete winner Sebastian Bourdais looked like he'd rebound after a tough weekend at Phoenix. However, the driver who started sixth wouldn't make it past lap six. Mechanical woes knocked the 18 out early. With 20 laps in the books, Ryan Hunter-Reay, the 2012 IndyCar champ, climbed to fifth after starting eighth. He made this great pass on Rossi, who started ninth. And a tip of the helmet to Graham Rahal this race weekend. After struggles in the early part of the season, the 15 team found some speed. At the halfway point, Dixon and Hunter-Reay would be in the top five. Rahal picked off five more competitors. He moved into eighth and would lead some laps as the field cycled through green flag pit stops. RHR kept the hammer down, charging to third before the checkers fell in Indy.
This is a nice strong start, sets the momentum, and it's nice to bring home a result, figuring that we've had a lot of bad luck this year, you know, a lot of misfortune and things just haven't gone our way, so nice to get the ball rolling.
That put two Hondas on the podium. Rahal in sixth, Max Chilton in seventh, and Alexander Rossi in eighth. This would be Rahal's best finish of the season.
Yeah, I mean, we just had a great day, you know, a good solid day. We passed a lot of guys. Car was extreme. I struggled on blacks a little bit, but the car was extremely good on reds. I felt dialed in. I felt good.
One of the most interesting stories this month has been the sojourn of Michael Shank Racing. MSR fields the Acura team in the IMSA Sports Car Championship. For team principal Mike Shank, it's been a long-held desire to bring a car to the Indy 500. He did that this year for rookie driver Jack Harvey. MSR is a small outfit, only 20 full-time employees, so that trip from IMSA to Indy and back again has been quite a journey.
Imagine the thing you dreamed about the most as a kid and that actually happening. It's great. It's the top of the rung for me. None gets higher, and it's going really well so far.
The number one priority in our life is the Acura NSX project behind us here. As long as we have that covered at a satisfactory rate, then I'm good with Indy, and now we do. So after we leave COTA, the Acura go to a 7-post rig in Charlotte. And so half the guys go do that, and then half the guys go to Indianapolis and move in on May 11th. When the Acura is off the 7-post, the NSX off the 7-post, they prep those cars and get them ready for Detroit. The rest of that team comes and meets us at Indy and help pit the car for the second week at Indianapolis. I'll do Indianapolis, and then the whole show moves to Detroit.
You know, it's a lot of work and a lot of preparation goes into it. We're looking forward to the challenge, and certainly it is a challenge, but it's a challenge that we look forward to.
Basically just coming out of the pit lane, just building a little bit of speed in the slow lane or the warm-up lane, went to turn in turn two. I just went straight, went across the grass, hit the wall, and that was that.
First lap was good, but we couldn't maintain it, and the balance shifted too far away to be able to do anything with it. So, yeah, this disappointing run, I think, for everybody. Then
I hate it for him. We're all digging as hard as we can, but I mean, think about what he did. He hit the wall and kept going. We'll have to work on the race car now. We'll probably end up in the second or third to last row.
I guess car spun after I hit the debris. I don't know how you dodge it. Sometimes it was just, I think the car was running really well. We were making really good progress and we had some decent speed. You know, to see it slip away like it did is it's just heartbreaking. I know how hard the team have had to work to get here, so I'm gutted for them.
So proud and happy of all my guys here. We're off to Detroit with the same group next week. They did nothing but everything we asked of them. I'm beyond proud of them all. I've told them all that. It is disappointing. We definitely had higher expectations than this. Just got to thank Honda for once again sticking to be behind us.
And there is more to come on this edition of Honda Racing at Speed. We'll focus on those Acura NSX race cars. First, we'll take it a circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas, to see how the MSR team fared in the fourth IMSA race of the season. We'll check in on the real-time racing squad as well, and Pirelli World Challenge with their very similar Acuras. Back-to-back battles in the Northeast, and the highlights are coming up. We here back on Honda Racing at Speed. The first three races of the IMSA Sports Car Championship this season have been radically different. The longest race of the year at Daytona, the toughest physical test at Sebring, the shortest race of the year at Long Beach, and then it was on to the Texas Hill Country. Kyle Benjamin tells us that the Michael Shank Racing Team was hoping a change of scenery might be just what the engineers ordered for their Acura NSX GTs.
It seems like all MSR needs to get to the podium with the NSX GT3 would be a change in luck. Circumstances beyond human control derailed those hopes in every race so far.
And it literally just sucked the hood off at about 170 miles an hour.
We had that damper go down.
On the very last corner, we get drilled.
It looked like this would change at Circuit of the Americas, but fate had other plans. An early charge by Catherine Legg put the 93 out front. But at pit road, penalty after the driver change put the 93's quest for solid results on hold.
The car ran fast. You know, we gapped the leader. You know, I was getting a delta to the leader every time, and we opened on it. So it's the first time we've done that.
The 86, driven by Oz Negri and Jeff Siegel, fell victim to fuel mileage. Theirs was too good. The caution they needed to capitalize on the Acura's economy came too late. Siegel, though, rallied for a top 10 finish.
Top 10 finish is not a terrible thing. It's valuable points that are scored, but you know, this team, this whole effort, this manufacturer, we deserve a big result.
Team owner Michael Shank says better qualifying results should translate into better race results.
As for Acura's other race team, Real Time Racing, well, they work very closely with Michael Shank's team to further develop the Acura NSX GT platform. They run the cars at Pirelli World Challenge, which is a very tough series. Todd Lewis tells us that development is moving nicely, although weather at Mosport was not their friend.
The real-time racing Acura NSX GT3 team battling during the fourth weekend of the Pirelli World Challenge at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park with a doubleheader of Sprint X races. Mark Wilkins teamed with Peter Cox in the number 93. Tom Dyer joined Ryan Eversley in the 43 Acura. Eversley felt the bumpers from behind but worked to hold station in race one. A quick handoff to co-driver Dyer kept the real-time car in the fight. The duo improved one spot on the day. Wilkins jumped his NSX GT3 forward ahead of Eversley and into the top 10 before the driver switch. Cox brought the car home to a ninth place result. The home track advantage was evident for Mark Wilkins, who was pleased with round one.
We had a pretty strong race right from the start. We made up a few places and fought really, really hard. You know, Peter got in, we had a good pit stop, we made up three places there. And all in all, a really strong result for the car. The car's in one piece, but it's been pretty quick. We'll continue to develop for tomorrow and we'll come back stronger.
Heavy rain showers took over the Bowmanville, Ontario track Sunday with conditions so bad it was unsafe for cars to race. BWC will reschedule the race for later in the season. The following weekend, Acura teams tackled Lime Rock Park and made an immediate impression with their best qualifying efforts of the season to date. Wilkins and Cox posted a seventh place finish in the first event of the weekend in the 93, while Eversley and Dyer hustled to a fifth place result in their Acura.
I think from a performance metric, we did really well here in qualifying with Ryan bringing it in fourth. We were actually kind of happy to see the wet conditions because we know we're very good in that. But we also feel like we'd be pretty solid here at this track because it caters to some of our strengths, and that's proving to be true because the race was in the dry and, you know, we're able to stay on the top five and bring home a top five, so that was very good.
Tom Dyer carried Friday's momentum into the second race. He vaulted his number 43 Acura forward from fifth to third. Wilkins also gained spots, jumping from 12th on the grid up to 7th before the switch to Cox, who gained one more spot, and the 93 finished in 6th. A small bobble on the driver switch cost the 43 NSX team, and Eversley would claim a 5th place result. Back-to-back, 5th place finishes are solid progress, but left Eversley wanting more.
Frustrating race for that, but I mean, hey, top 5, I'm bummed to be 5th, and that's a really good problem to have for this program because we've struggle to make it in the top 10. So this is a really good day all in all. I just feel bad for the guys because we made a dumb, tiny little mistake and that's all it costs. So we'll get there.
Following the events at CTMP and Lime Rock, it's clear the real-time Acura NSX GT3 team have made significant progress as we head into summer.
We are not done yet. When we return on this edition of Honda Racing at Speed, an update on the condition of Honda IndyCar star Sebastian Bourdais. We'll be back.
Honda Racing at Speed is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams, Honda Racing, and Honda Performance Development. Find out more at hpd.honda.com.
and we welcome you back. One of the toughest moments in this month of May had to be a violent crash on qualifying weekend leading up to the Indy 500. It involved Honda ace Sebastian Bourdais. The four-time Champ Car champion and St. Petersburg winner this year hit the wall hard coming off turn two on lap three of his qualifying effort. Bourdais was the fastest driver in qualifying early on Saturday. He'd run 231 miles an hour plus on his first two laps before disaster struck as Bourdais exited turn two on lap three. After the hit, Seb never lost consciousness. All the safety features in his Dale Coyne Honda, his Hans device, and the safer barriers here at IMS, all contributing to Bourdais coming through the incident with a broken hip and fractured pelvis, something that could have been a whole lot worse. He's already out of the hospital after surgery and starting his rehab. Bourdais hopes to be back in the race car before the season ends.
It's going to take whatever time it's going to take, but I know it's going to come back, so it doesn't really matter how hard or how long it's going to be. I think hopefully the 3 months usual bone healing process is not going to take more than that, and I can, you know, come back for Sonoma, which is my personal target.
Well, that's all the time we have on this edition of Honda Racing at Speed. Next month when we come to you, we'll have highlights of the Baja 500 Team Honda Racing Ridgeline going for Baja honors once again. We'll take a look at the Acura NSX as it makes progress in IMSA and Pirelli World Challenge. Honda's IndyCar stars busy in Detroit and Texas and Road America. Tons of IndyCar highlights. And we'll keep you posted on the F4 United States Championship. They come and race here on the road course at Indy for the first time ever. All that and more next month on Honda Racing at Speed. Until then, I'm Rick Benjamin. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.